bring a container to bring home your extra crepes that you're going to make, okay, and also just even some of the mixture. Okay, I would recommend that you bring a sealed container, one even, I don't know, even if you only bring half a milk bottle of milk, like a one with a screw lid, and you can put your mixture back in and you can make the crepes fresh at home. They're much nicer. If you take them home, they tend to get a bit rubbery. And then the following week, so you're going to do your standard recipe cards this time next week, so, and I'll make sure that I help you guys if you have a few questions and you're not quite getting it right. But the signature dish, if you want to challenge yourself, do the souffles. Now, however, if you do these berry souffles, these chocolate berry souffles, you need to have little ramekins like this. You can, if you want to, if you've got a cup at home, if you like the cups at home that look like this, around that shape, you can also use those. If you don't have like a ramekin like that, often in a lot of restaurants that serve up souffles, they will have like little white cups like this. Has anybody seen those? You can actually use those as well, okay? However, if you're going to do the souffles, you need to eat them straight away, okay? Because what I'm going to do today is I will make them, and then you can pretty much find a partner and share and things like that, because it will come out of the oven about this high, and then within a few moments it will deflate because it's mostly air. So I'm going to teach you how to work with egg whites and things like that, which make it look really cool. Next term as well, there is also, not next term, term three, where you're doing entrees, there's also a cheese souffle, if you like, as well, okay? So I'm doing the sweet one today, and the savoury one you can do in term three, okay? But you will get to eat it today. So if you want your signature dish, but the signature dish that you're going to do next Thursday, you need to be either a catch-up lesson, because considering you didn't do your catch-up today, so something that you haven't done yet that needs to go into your logbook, or say, for instance, you forgot to take a photograph and so on, you can cook it again. Okay, a lot of people forgot to do their brownie photograph, or make another brownie and then take another photograph to put in your assignment. But something sweet that you can show off and make it look like you really did well. Okay, so that's next Thursday. And then after that, we will start our new unit, which will be nutrition and working on a diet for a adolescent athlete. Okay, so that's
it. What are those containers called?
They're called ramekins. Ramekins. Okay. So, the very first thing you need to do with these ramekins is, when it comes to, if you wanted to do it the really traditional way, what you'd do is you'd have a tray like this that was quite deep, and you'd have your ramekins in some water, okay? But we're not going to do that today because it's obviously very messy and it's not always that necessary. Not if you're not doing it for a restaurant or anything like that, and you people are going to be eating it straight away. But the most important thing that you're going to need to do is to make a good souffle, you've got to grease your ramekins really, really well. And the way I do that is, because I'm going to use a lot of this butter, I'm going to get this butter like this, boys, like that, yep, and you need to use your block of butter, and you're going to bring it so that you're greasing it right to the very edge, so that corner of my butter is going into the corner of my ramekin, and the edge is going right up to the top, okay, so you're going to butter that all the way across, okay, making sure that everything is greased, because the fact is, your souffle is going to rise really high, and you don't want any part of your dish to prevent this souffle from rising. Because if it gets caught on the edge, what happens is your souffle's got to go right up with the air. But if it gets caught on the edge, it's actually going to become lopsided. Okay? So say, for instance, if there's not greased properly and it gets stuck on the edge, your whole souffle's going to go sideways and then plop out of your souffle as it rises. And we don't want that. So get the grease right up, or the butter, right up the edge. Okay? You can, if you wish, put some butter on a piece of baking paper and use the baking paper to wipe it around. But this for me is easier. And also I don't get grease all over my hands. Okay, so I'm going to do a number of them. Okay, making sure that it goes right up. So you need to get a partner, because you and a partner will be able to share it. Now you can, this recipe is traditionally actually a chocolate pear souffle, so if you wanted to put pears in it, you can. I think berries and chocolate sort of go like strawberries and cream, they just go hand in hand. But you can put pear in it if you wish.
Pear.
Now, then what you do, this is not finished yet. So once you've got it will completely the grease in it or the butter, you're going to put I've got a quarter of a cup of sugar here, and you're going to cover all of that right up to the edge in sugar. So you just get the next ramekin that you're going to fill underneath it, okay, and you rotate that right around so that is covered in both butter and sugar, okay? So each one, you make sure you've got enough sugar in there. Just roll it, rotate it around. Okay. Have you ever seen one of those gumball machines where they make gumballs?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? So, and how it rolls around and then it covers the whole gumball with sugar? Well, you're just covering the edge of this. Okay? So everyone, you've got to do so. This is the most important part of your souffle, making sure that these ramekins are actually greased properly. Covered properly. And if you run out, then you just get some more. Butter. and you're going to, rather than being over a double boiler, I just do it straight into the microwave, because the butter will get really hot and it will melt your chocolate for you. So just throw all of that in there. Okay, so melt that chocolate and butter really well. The next thing that you're going to do, you get 150 grams. Does everybody know how to use these? I've taught you how to use the white.
Oh, yeah.
Does everyone know how to use these electronic ones?
Probably.
Yeah?
Probably.
So what you do, just put the power on, okay? Then you're going to put whatever you're going to measure in on top of it and press zero, okay? Then anything that goes into that now, so I need 150 grams of sugar, it will begin to measure it. So actually a quarter of a cup is 50 grams, so it's three quarters of a cup is 150 grams, okay? And into that, we're going to beat get together our sugar now and our egg whites. Everybody knows that when we do egg whites, to make a good pavlova or a good meringue, how do you make sure that your egg whites get a little poofy? Or, better yet, what would be a better question is, what would prevent your egg whites from getting nice and puffy? What sort of things would stop? Anybody worked with egg whites before? Yes?
Is it if you like mix it with something else, it will, if you mix it with the sugar as well, it won't?
No, we will be throwing this sugar in, yeah? But we'll be putting it, but there is a couple of things that could prevent your egg whites from getting nice and puffy. Yep? No, that will happen. The things that are really going to ever prevent your egg whites from getting up or getting puffy is having a little bit of egg yolk in there. The egg yolk will prevent it. So for instance, there's got to be completely only egg whites. And the other thing is, if your beaters have got any bit of fat or oil or anything like that, or your bowls are not clean, like this one, they're not clean and they're not rid of any fat or oil or dirt, then that could prevent it. Any little bit of yolk or any little bit of oil or fat or things like that will actually prevent it. And you could be beating your egg whites until Christmas and they still won't get nice and puffy. Okay? So make sure that anything you use is completely clean and doesn't have any oil or fat. And then your egg whites will get really nice and light. The other thing that will help it is something like cream of tartar or a teaspoon of vinegar, okay? That will actually help also your egg whites to be nice and firm. So, but today, because I don't have any vinegar, I'm going to use a little bit of cream of tartar. So, first let me melt this. This is my butter and my chocolate. Now, because my butter was really hot, it's now melted my chocolate. So I just give that a stir, and then I let that cool down while I'm doing my egg yolks. So that's, just make sure every bit of chocolate is melted. And you can see that now. Beautiful and silky and shiny because of the butter. All right. So here's my sugar that I'm going to add, and I've got my cream of tartar ready. Just make sure that my beaters here are nice and clean. Now there's no guarantee of being a Now this is where you're also, because you're going to be doing four, I did get eggs in there. Because you're going to be doing four, you've got to make sure that you have got a Pyrex jug for your egg yolks and a Pyrex jug for your egg whites, and then you're going to put your fresh ones that you actually do successfully separate into here. Don't think that you're going to put all the egg whites together in here, because highly likely, and this has happened to me before, where you get to the last egg white and you stuff it. And then you've got all this egg yolk there and you've got to throw all of your egg whites away because it's got a little bit of egg yolk in it. Okay? So what you're going to do is you're going to do them one by one.
Did break this time.
I know. Thank you, Lord. Alright. So
thank you, Ed.
Thank you, Ed. Okay, so that's one successful one, so I'm going to put that straight away in there. And that means if I do stuff it, I'm only throwing away one egg rather than four. Okay? And then next one. Okay, put that one in. That was another successful one. Or whether you've got a bit of oil. If you had oil on that, upright and it points upright and it stays there. If it's soft, you lift your feet up and you go like that and it actually just...
Yeah!
And it folds, and it folds down on itself. See how that's just folding over? Like really softly, like a wave. Okay, that's called side piece, okay? So, if I keep eating that, that will eventually get to the point where I can lift my beater and actually hold upright. This, however, this recipe, I think it says go until it's nice and creamy or something, but I can't remember. Yeah, until creamy. Okay, this, rest, this icing here, not icing, this meringue is just really creamy, okay? So this is, I'm happy with that and it's going to work. Now that I've got this nice and airy, I'm not going to then get my beaters and bash it down and get rid of all that air, okay? So that would be useless. So what we need to do is just get yourself a knife and just clean your beaters like that, okay?
Yum.
All right, so that's ready to fold into my mixture in a moment. Okay, next thing, we're just going to, have you noticed that it said to melt my chocolate and butter and set aside to cool? Well, the reason being is I'm going to now add my egg yolks to that chocolate. If I hadn't added it straight away before it had cooled down, what's going to happen to those egg yolks? So yeah, they'll cook in the chocolate, okay? So we wanted that chocolate to cool down a little bit before we added that. So I'll just wait a few seconds. Okay, next thing we're going to do is we're going to get 200 grams of flour. So we get our little trusty scales. Chocolate and the flour together. most or second to. You've got your gooey chocolate here now, but we've got to get this gooey chocolate and this mixture together as light as possible, okay? So what you're going to do is get some of your mixture and you're going to slowly incorporate that together. You're not going to do it really rough, where it's going, you're going to get rid of all of that air. You're going to just very gently fold your mixture together. So very carefully fold it together like that. Then you're going to get a little bit more. And just gently incorporate those two together. Now you don't want the heaviness of the chocolate to predominate, you want the lightness of the meringue to be the factor that actually makes this work.
I'll lick it.
I'll lick it. sure that all of your berries are completely covered, okay, by the chocolate mixture. And that way those berries will be nice and soft and cooked and juicy when you get them out. Well, if you don't eat it straight away, it will have deflated and so on.